हाय दोस्तों, आई एम सी आदित्य अग्रवाल एंड टुडे वी हैव अ वेरी स्पेशल गेस्ट विद अस, सी ए सूरज भल्ला जी. आई वेलकम यू ऑन दिस चैनल. टू गिव अ ब्रीफ इंट्रो ऑफ मिस्टर सूरज, ही इज अ चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट एंड हैविंग प्रैक्टिकल एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ जीएसटी एंड इनडायरेक्ट टैक्सेस फॉर मोर देन 9 ईयर्स. एंड टुडे ही विल बी डिस्कसिंग अपॉन वन ऑफ द बर्निंग इशूज, दैट इज ITC on works contract and construction services on GST. So I'll not take much of the viewers' time and over to you, Suraj ji.
थैंक यू आदित्य जी. हेलो फ्रेंड्स, टुडे वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग वेरी हॉट टॉपिक दैट एवरी सेसी फेसेस इन हिज लाइफ टाइम, एटलीस्ट वंस अ लाइफ टाइम, दैट इज ITC ऑन कंस्ट्रक्शन सर्विसेज एंड कंस्ट्रक्शन ऑफ अ फैक्ट्री. डियर फ्रेंड्स, फर्स्ट टू अंडरस्टैंड वेदर द ITC इज एलिजिबल ऑन वर्क्स कॉन्ट्रैक्ट एंड कंस्ट्रक्शन सर्विसेज फॉर ऑफिस, फैक्ट्री, एनी ऑफिस प्रीमाइसेस. सो फर्स्ट वी हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड वेयर दिस डेफिनेशन एंड वेयर दिस वर्ड्स आर डिफाइंड इन GST एक्ट. सो देर इज अ सेक्शन इन सेक्शन 2 सबसेक्शन 119 इन CGST एक्ट विच सेज दैट वर्क्स कॉन्ट्रैक्ट मीन्स अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट ऑफ फॉर बिल्डिंग, कंस्ट्रक्शन, फेब्रिकेशन, इरेक्शन, इंस्टॉलेशन, फिटिंग आउट, इंप्रूवमेंट, मॉडिफिकेशन, रिपेयर, मेंटेनेंस, रेनोवेशन, ऑल्टरेशन और कमीशनिंग ऑफ एनी इमूवेबल प्रॉपर्टी. सो द वर्ड वी हैव टू टेक केयर इज दैट वर्क कॉन्ट्रैक्ट इज मच वाइडर देन कंस्ट्रक्शन. वर्क कॉन्ट्रैक्ट इंक्लूड्स कंस्ट्रक्शन एंड देर आर 14 टर्म्स यूज एंड दैट टू ओनली फॉर इमूवेबल प्रॉपर्टी. सो देर इज अ शिफ्ट फ्रॉम द प्रीवियस वैट लॉस. इन प्रीवियस वैट लॉस दिस टर्म वॉज इवन यूज फॉर इमूवेबल प्रॉपर्टी एज वेल. नाउ वर्क कॉन्ट्रैक्ट is only used for immovable property. So here the taxability and whether this is a supply of goods or services, it has been specifically deemed in schedule 3 of CGST act that the works contract shall be deemed to be a supply of service and taxed accordingly. So for checking whether the input will be allowed or not, we have to check the section which allows for the input in CGST act. There is a section 16(1) which says that every registered person shall be eligible to take the input tax charge on any supply of goods or services or both to him, which are used or intended to be used in the course or furtherance of his business. So first of all, the factory premises or the office which we are constructing, of course, they are in the course or furtherance of his business of a businessman. But there are other clauses which will help us to understand whether this ITC is eligible or not. There is section 17 subsection 5, which is a non-obstante clause. It says that notwithstanding anything contained in section 6, section 16 subsection 1, input tax credit shall not be available in respect of the following. So there is a list, negative list given in this, in regard of which the input shall not be allowed. I am coming directly to the topic. So there is clause C and D in section 17(5). 17(5C) says that input shall not be allowed in case of work contract services received, except where it is an input service for further supply of works contract service. So the work contract service input is barred except when I am a further providing this same service. Also in section 17(5D), it states that goods or services received by a taxable person for construction of a immovable property on his own account, even when used in the course or furtherance of business. So there are two clauses. We have to be careful. In C, they have covered work contract. If we have given a contract to a single person that he will provide both goods and services, it becomes a work contract and input is barred in this section. In clause D, if we are purchasing goods and we are procuring services for construction of our immovable property, even in that case, input is not allowed even when it is used in the course or furtherance of business. So this is a non-obstante clause and it is a negative list. And we also have to see the definition of explanation regarding construction. It says that construction includes reconstruction, renovation, additions or alterations or repairs to the extent of capitalization. Even input is not allowed for construction, but even if there are any expenditures that we have capitalized, like of reconstruction, renovation, addition or alteration, or repairs as per our AS, Ind AS, even in that case, input will be barred. Coming forward, in this section, there is a exclusion. This input shall be allowed if this work contract or goods or services are received by taxable person for construction of plant and machinery. So for purchase or construction of plant and machinery, this input shall be allowed, and they are not in the negative list as per this both clauses that has been excluded. So plant and machinery input shall be allowed. So while constructing our premises, factory, we have to see whether the equipment or the item is coming in plant and machinery or as a civil structure. So input is barred in case of civil works only as per this clauses. So we have to see whether the product is a plant and machinery, item is a plant and machinery or civil work for each and every case individually. So let's discuss few cases. Plant and machinery, equipment, structural support or foundation of plant and machinery, DG sets, firefighting, electrical equipment, lift. As per my understanding, this all will go in the definition of plant and machinery. This all will go in the definition of plant and machinery, and input shall be allowed in these cases. Even input shall be allowed for furniture, because furniture is not immovable property. Furniture is a movable property. So while allocating the contracts, the work contract or the construction contract, we have to be very careful that input is not allowed in case of civil work, but input is allowed in the case of plant and machinery or other equipments. So we should allot or hire a separate contractor or enter into a separate contract for civil work and plant and machinery. Because if we enter into a single turnkey contract for construction of our factory, what will happen is the main part of the supply will be the civil construction. So the entire supply will become civil construction, and our input can be barred in this section 17.5 C and D. So we must enter into a separate contract. We should issue a separate PO and even receive a separate bill for civil construction and plant and machinery, so that we are eligible. We can claim as much input as is possible as per law. And we should be careful that even these contracts must not be interlinked, and there should not be any crossfall breach between these contracts. Now, what is plant and machinery? There is an explanation in section 17.6 which says that plant and machinery means apparatus, equipment, and machinery fixed to earth, foundation or structural support that are used for making output supply of goods or services or both, and includes such foundation and structural supports. So plant and machinery is defined in this explanation for the purpose of claiming of ITC. So let us discuss few case studies that whether this is in a plant and machinery or not. There was a case of State of Kerala versus Ambuja Cements, where the cement manufacturer Ambuja Cements were having huge silos that were having capacity up to 10,000 metric tons. These were part of the machineries, but the silos were constructed with cement and steel itself. So in this decision, the High Court gave a very landmark decision and said that merely for the reason that some machinery or part of the silos are made out of steel and cement, this doesn't mean that it becomes a civil structure. If it is a plant and machinery and steel and cement are used, still input shall be allowed for the plant and machinery. So silos form integral part of the plant and machinery, so input was allowed in this case. And I will be discussing an authoritative advance ruling given by Karnataka, a ruling given by Karnataka Advance Ruling Authority in September 2019, where applicant Keshav Cement and Infra Limited is a cement manufacturer. The company constructed a separate solar plant, and the case went to the high. They went to the advance ruling to see that whether the input shall be allowed in respect of the solar plant or not. So here the advance ruling ruled that apparatus, equipment and machinery which are fixed to earth by foundation or structural support alone are entitled to qualify as plant and machinery. So solar plant is a plant and machinery, and the input was eligible to the SSC and will be eligible to the SSC. And they rightfully said that the applicant shall be entitled to eligible input tax credits in entirety, providing the entire production of electricity is captively consumed. The electricity is a exempt supply. So in case if electricity will be sold to power grid, in that case, reversal is required to be done as per section 17(2) read with rule 42. So in this case, I will crystallize the decision. In this, it was decided that solar plant is part of plant and machinery and input shall be allowed on the expenses, capital expenditure or revenue expenditure done in the construction of this plant and machinery, that is solar plant. Now, there was a decision at the time of excise in 2011 by Andhra Pradesh High Court in the case of CCE versus Sai Samhita Storage Private Limited. In this case, the High Court held that if the company is providing storage and warehousing services, they are eligible to take credit of ITC of excise duty paid on cement or TMT bars which were used in the construction of the warehouse. So this was a landmark judgment in excise time. Now, post GST, there is a similar case, Safari Retreats Private Limited versus Chief Commissioner of Central Goods and Service Tax 2019, pronounced by Odisha High Court. In this, the applicant Safari Retreats is engaged in letting out of the shopping malls. Safari Retreats constructs its own shopping malls and commercial complex, and then these are let it out on rent. So in this case, it was contended by the Council of Safari Retreats that the purpose of the GST Act is to provide uniform provision for levy of collection of tax and to prevent multi-taxation. And also he said that the shopping mall which the SSE is constructing is neither intended for sale nor on its own account, but it is intended for letting out. So here, while taking the High Court, while pronouncing their decision, they use a language that I will like to read for you. They said that while considering the provisions of section 17(5)(d), the narrow construction of interpretation put forward by the department is frustrating the very objective of the act. And they decided that the SSE since the SSE is required to pay GST on rental income arising out of this investment, that was construction expenses that done by the SSE, he is eligible to claim this ITC, which he has expended on construction of the malls and shopping complexes. But we have to wait. This case is pending with the Supreme Court. So as per my humble submission, what we can do if our SSE is facing similar situation. So what we can do is we can avail the input tax credit, but we should not utilize. And we can take decision later at a later stage after a decision comes of the Supreme Court or there is some amendment in law. So here I would like to conclude my webinar and thank you very much for listening to me patiently. Thank you.
Thank you, Suraj bhai. It was a wonderful deliberation on ITC related to works contract and construction services. Aapne bahut acche se, you have very well explained the provisions, the sections, the relevant sections of the act by taking consideration of all the relevant authority of advance rulings and High Court judgment. So now to all the viewers, we will come up with more such videos related to recent burning issues on GST and other professional updates. So I request you all to please subscribe our channel, keep liking and sharing our videos. Thank you so much. Thank you, Suraj ji.
Thank you.